Before we begin, I would like to state that all songs accompanying this lecture recital were pre-recorded individually, and all video was filmed separately to maintain COVID guidelines. My junior year, I found myself in Dr. Samuel Dorff's music and gender course, rushing to find a final topic project. I knew I wanted to do something on female singer-songwriters, and I think truthfully, I was just looking for my love of songwriting again. So I typed into Google, top songwriters of all time, leading me to Rolling Stone's 100 greatest singer-songwriters of all time. Now I knew subconsciously there probably weren't going to be a lot of women on this list, but what I found led me down a rabbit hole that is now this lecture recital that I'm presenting to you today. There are 15 women total on this list. 9 are accredited as solos, and 6 are alongside of a man. The highest women ranking on this list include Joni Mitchell at number 9 and Carole King with Jerry Goffin at number 7. And as I kept reading the bios of these women, I realized that they either fell into one of two categories. Either 1, they were directly partnered with a man, or 2, they were referred to as a confessionalist. Now, as I kept reading the bios of other songwriters on this list, I realized that when the word confessional came up for men, it was in reference to a specific song or an album. But for women, it was they themselves as an artist. In this lecture recital, I would like to address a few questions. One is, what is the confessionalist genre? And also, why does it matter? The other is, what do these women who have been dubbed by music critics for decades as confessionalists feel about it? Or how do they feel about their songwriting? To answer the question, what is the confessional genre? We have to boil it down to the root word, which is confession. Now, we know this in two contexts, the religious and the legal, although both include a way of admitting wrongdoing or sin. Both include guilt and shame, and both include a confessor and somebody who is listening to the confession. The confessionalist movement began in contemporary American poetry in the 1950s. Now, this is when there was a stray from the formal and structured format of poetry into something more personal. And we remember specifically women like Anne Sexton and Sylvia Plath, who wrote about incredibly taboo topics and extremely personal experiences. Music critics since the 1990s started using this vocabulary when describing American female singer-songwriters. They describe them as deeply personal diary entries, cathartic therapy sessions, confessions, overshares, and emotionally laden girl-to-girl conversations. Now, these subtly sexist labels pigeonhole women's music into this land of private and personal. And it just draws on stereotypes as women as hyper-emotional, self-focused, and incapable of contributing intelligently to political and social movements. Now, this leads to many problems with this, and it leads us into why this even matters. The distinct vocabulary we use to describe female singer-songwriters is incredibly important for a few reasons. One of which is because this concept of diary completely overshadows the deeper subtext of music, including women's calls for political and systemic change. Now, this is because critics tend to emphasize, whether consciously or subconsciously, the artist's emotions rather than their statements on the female experience itself. Emmy the Great, a singer-songwriter who came to prominence about 40 years after Joni Mitchell, who is the arguable poster child of confessionalism, has a great quote. She says, "A male singer-songwriter might play on the same themes as a female singer-songwriter, and it may end up being assumed that the girl is singing from her diary, and the boy is making statements on the big themes of life." This quote launched my entire research into this project. Another reason is because by contributing the success and brilliance of this artist's work to the confessionalist concept, we further the patriarchal and misogynistic undertones of the music industry and society. Marika Hackman, who's also a singer-songwriter, explains that this genre suggests that women lack the imagination to write about anything other than their exact literal lives. This also furthers the expectations about gender performance of women. This includes common ones that we know, such as being silent or submissive, and we like to believe that we live in a society where these things don't apply anymore. Although part of the female experience is recognizing other undertones, such as being polite and correct, and anything that is not these things is not acceptable. They're shameful. They're something to feel embarrassed about. By deeming these women who speak on taboo topics that are not necessarily considered polite confessionalists, we further explain that by speaking out on these things, they should be ashamed of them. Through the words of Joni Mitchell, who explains confessionalism as trials, witch hunts, and other degrading things, that this is all this is intended to do. Again, whether consciously or subconsciously, by deeming these women confessionalists, we are telling them that they are degrading and humiliating themselves rather than validating their experience. A separate example from this is one of the only true confessionalist male artists that I've been able to find, at least as critics say, which is Frank Ocean, who it wasn't until he came out as gay that people went back to his music and said, oh, these are confessions. He's speaking about a man when we all thought he was speaking about a woman. This just furthers the idea that anything out of the norm is not acceptable and therefore is a confession rather than experience. Finally, I would like to answer my question of what do these women think about the confessionalist genre and how do they describe their songwriting? We begin with Joni Mitchell, who, again, is arguably the poster child for confessionalism, but ironically is probably the most outspoken woman on this list about being called a confessionalist. During the late 1960s and 70s, Joni wrote her lyrics often about her personal life. And because of this, she became the confessionalist singer-songwriter. Now, she doesn't deny that her songs are often more autobiographical than most people's, but she has a problem with the word confession. Quoted, she says, "When I think of confession, two things come to mind. The swinging light in the billy club, you know, trying to get a confession out of somebody that's been captured. Confess, confess, or a witch hunt or trials. Confession is somebody trying to beat something out of you externally. You're imprisoned, you're captured." As a lyricist, Joni's goal was never to reveal truths about herself, but rather find a way to explain human truths through her own personal stories. She also believes that by categorizing music as confessions, it removes the art. She, who categorizes herself as a painter first, believes that art is artifice and it doesn't matter whose life I scraped to get that. Of course, I have more access to my own. If you spend a lot of time alone, that's your major resource, your own experience. But I am not making these songs out of a need to confess to anyone. It is out of a need to create a story. Joni Mitchell's whole point is that it doesn't matter that it may have began with her own personal story. That's because that is her major resource. It's the book that she owns, not the one she needs to go check out at the library. She can read it over and over again and analyze every word to create even more stories. She hates to be put into the box of confessionalism. And as she says in an interview, "I am fluid. Everything I am not." And that's the way it is with all people if they really observe themselves. She goes on to say, "It's the one thing I've been trying to get across to people, I think, is you're on your own. Let's face it. And that's okay. It's okay to remove the crutches." Joni believes that the crutches is this concept of saying, oh, this is about that person and this person. It's the answers that people want when they listen to music, but in reality, they need to observe themselves. I would now like to present to you my self-accompanied cover of Joni Mitchell's A Case of You.
Just before our love got lost, you said, I am as constant as a northern star, and I said, constantly in the darkness, where's that at? If you want me, I'll be in the bar. On the back of a cartoon coaster, in the blue TV screen light, I drew a map of Canada, oh Canada, with your face sketched on it twice. Oh, you're in my blood like holy wine. You taste so bitter and so sweet. Oh, I could drink a case of you, darling, and I would still be on my feet. Oh, I would still be on my feet. Box of paints. I'm frightened by the devil, and I'm drawn to those ones that ain't afraid. I remember that time you told me, you said, love is touching souls. Surely you've touched mine, 'cause part of you pours out of me. Lines from time to time. Oh, but you are in my blood, you're my holy wine. You taste so bitter and so sweet. Oh, I could drink a case of you, darling. Still, I'd be on my feet. Oh, I would still be on my feet. She needed life, she needed devils in your deeds. And she said, go to him, stay with him if you can, but be prepared to bleed. Oh, you are in my blood, you're my holy wine. You taste so bitter and so sweet. Oh, I could drink case of you, ooh, darling. Still, I'd be on my feet. Oh, I would still be on my feet.
Carol King is a singer-songwriter who has been writing songs for herself and other big artists since she was a teenager. When she's asked about her songwriting process, she explains that every song, just like every single person on this earth, is different. In one interview, she was questioned about her song, You've Got a Friend, badgered about who it was about, who she was thinking about, and who was in her head. She explained, "I wasn't thinking of a specific person. It was almost as if something was writing through me rather than me writing, and I just wanted to make sure I got it and I could do it again." She goes on to explain that this is how she feels about most songs, that even though she may sound like she's singing about her own life, really she's just trying to find this voice that she feels through inspiration. And this also applies to the song You Make Me Feel Like a Natural Woman. She wrote this song with Aretha Franklin in mind. And so it doesn't really bother her when people think it's Aretha's song, because she feels like she made it her own. It is her song. But when Carol decided to re-record it for her Tapestry album, she wanted to bring it back to her roots and exactly find how she was feeling when she wrote it. And I would like to make it my own. So this is my cover of Carole King's You Make Me Feel Like a Natural Woman, accompanied by Luke Grishow.
Looking out on the morning rain, I used to feel uninspired. And when I knew I had to face another day, Lord, it made me feel so tired. Before the day I met you, life was so unkind. Your love was the key to my peace of mind. When my soul was in the lost and found, you came along to claim it. I didn't know just what was wrong with me till your kiss helped me name it. Now I'm no longer doubtful of what I'm living for. 'Cause if I make you happy, I don't need to do more. You make me feel. You make me feel. You make me feel like a natural woman. You done to me, you make me feel so good inside, and I just wanna be close to you. You make me feel so alive. Natural woman, you make me feel. You make me feel. You make me feel like a natural woman. Natural woman.
When I began researching this project, I started watching interviews of these women, and I was especially excited for Stevie Nicks because in her bio on the Rolling Stones article, it said she and Buckingham were a couple when they joined Fleetwood Mac, but some of her greatest songs came out of the wreckage of their relationship. And this struck me because not only was she being paired with a man, but also all of her greatest works were being attributed to him and their damaged relationship. When asked about how she writes a song, she explains that it just starts with a little inspiration, that she might go out on the street and a man smiles at her and she'll go home and she'll write that the smile was the only thing she ever saw, or his smile was blinding. When she wrote Landslide, she was asked in countless interviews if it was about Lindsay. In one interview, she agrees and says, "I wrote it for Lindsay, for him, about him. It's dear to both of us because it's about us. We're out there singing about our lives." In another interview, she says, It's about a father-daughter relationship, as it was written the night before her dad was operated on. I think Stevie's conflicting interviews about what the song Landslide is about encapsulates perfectly the complexity of songwriting. That just because she says that it's written about something doesn't mean that it's written about only that. And just because she wrote it about that doesn't mean that it's about that for somebody else. The final story she gives about Landslide is that everybody seems to think that I wrote that song about them. Everybody in my family, all my friends, everybody. And my dad. My dad did have something to do with it, but he absolutely thinks that he was the whole complete reason it was ever written. She goes on to tell a story of her parents giving her about 6 months to continue doing her music because it wasn't really working out the way she had planned. So her and Lindsay went to Aspen, and he had gone off to go work with another band. She was feeling unhappy, lonely, and incredibly worried about their music career. She had $40, her dog, and a truck that barely worked. When Lindsay returned, they fought. He left her there, and when she finally got home, she followed him to LA. 2 months later, she got the call from Fleetwood Mac asking both her and Lindsay to join. She says that's what Landslide is about. It's about everything for her. All of those subjects. And here is my self-accompany cover of Landslide by Stevie Nicks, sung with Katie Breslin and Jennifer Rosio.
I took my love and I took it down. I climbed the mountain and I turned around. And I saw my reflection in the snow-covered hills while the landslide brought me down. Oh, mirror in the sky, what is love? Can the child within my heart rise above? Can I sail through the changing ocean tides? Can I handle the seasons of my bolder, and children get older, and I'm getting older too. Well, well, I've been afraid of changing, 'cause time makes you bolder, and children get older, and I'm getting older too. Well, so take this love and take it down. Yeah, if you climb a mountain and you turn around, and if you see my reflection in the snow-covered hills, well, the landslide brought me down. And if you see you down.
Taylor Swift is the youngest artist on this list, as well as the most mainstream artist of my generation on this list. The quote that Rolling Stone uses in her bio is, "Hi, I'm Taylor. I write songs about my feelings. I'm told I have a lot of feelings." Rolling Stone goes on to explain that she really hit her stride with the pop master of Red in 1989, especially on confessional ballads such as Clean and All Too Well. When Taylor is asked about her songwriting, she says, "I think as a songwriter, there is that urge to connect. This is how I feel sometimes. And then I have fans who say, oh my God, that's how I feel too." Taylor explains this whole concept when talking about one of her songs, The Man, in which she explains that if she was a man, she would get applauded for the way she wrote her songs. And she could get away with a lot more. She's often dismissed as gossiping about her exes in all of her music. This does not exclude All Too Well, which is undoubtedly a fan favorite and came after a 6-month writing block that followed a particularly painful ending of a relationship. Originally, the song was a 10-minute song to express that there's a kind of bad that gets so overpowering you can't even write about it. When you feel pain that is so far past dysfunctional that it leaves you with so many emotions that you can't filter them down to simple emotions to write about. And that's when you know you really need to get it out, as Taylor explained in an interview. In that interview, she was then asked if she ever felt guilty about writing about her exes. She says that she takes the songs and these people on a case-by-case basis, that if they're a good person, they wouldn't inspire a bad song. And if they handle a situation in a way that, quote, really messed up my life for a while, that's when she's gonna write about it. She says that, "For me, I never change the reason I write a song. Songs for me are more like a message in a bottle. You send them out to the world, and maybe the person you feel that way about will hear about it someday. Maybe they won't." Just because Taylor writes about her real life does not mean that it's a confession. She's no different than the previous artists we've talked about and the artists we'll continue to talk about. There's nothing shameful about her taking her personal experiences and presenting them to a world in hopes that somebody will relate to them. And I have definitely related to it. There have been many a times that I've screamed sang this song with my friends. And so with that, this is my cover of Taylor Swift's All Too Well.
Through the door with you, the air was cold, but something about it felt like home somehow. And I left my scarf there at your sister's house. You still got it in your drawer even now. Oh, your sweet disposition and my wide-eyed gaze. We're singing in the car, getting lost upstate. Autumn leaves falling down like pieces into place, and I can picture it after all these days. And I know it's long gone and that magic's not here no more, and I might be okay, but I'm not find it all. 'Cause there we are again on that little town street. Almost ran the red 'cause you were looking over me. Wind in my hair, I was there, I remember it all too well. Photo album on the counter, Your cheeks are turning red. Used to be a little kid with glasses and a twin-sized bed. Your mother's telling stories about you on the T-ball team. Tell me about your past, thinking your future was me. And I know it's long gone and there was nothing else I could do. Now forget about you long enough to forget why I needed to. Cause there we are again in the middle of the night. We're dancing around the kitchen in the refrigerator light. Down the stairs, I was there, I remember it all too well. Yeah. Maybe we got lost in translation. Maybe I asked for too much, but maybe this thing was a masterpiece till you tore it all up. Running scared, I was there, I remember it all too well. Hey, you call me up again just to break me like a promise, so casually, cruelly, in the name of being honest. I'm a crumpled up piece of paper lying here, 'cause I remember it all, all, all too well. Time won't fly, it's like I'm paralyzed by it. I'd like to be my old self again, but I'm still trying to find it. After plaid shirt days and nights where you made me your own, now you mail back my things and I walk home alone. But you keep my old scarf from that very first week, 'cause it reminds you of innocence and it smells like me. I can't get rid of it, 'cause you remember it all too well. Yeah. 'Cause there we are again when I loved you so. Back before we lost the one real thing you've ever known. It was rare, I was there, I remember it all too well. Wind in my hair, you down the stairs, you were there, you remember it all. It was rare, I was there, I remember it all too well.
Dolly Parton is a singer-songwriter who has written thousands of songs. And when asked about her process, she explains that it's her therapy. She says, "My guitar is my friend. When I'm in that zone, I call it my God zone." She's also become a feminist icon because she's unafraid to speak about the female experience. When she was asked if she realized while she was writing the songs that these would later become huge movement anthems, she explained, "I always wanted to speak my mind, speak my heart, but I wasn't thinking about it in terms of anything other than expressing myself as a woman. And by expressing myself, I'd expressed a lot of feelings of a lot of women that couldn't write a song or didn't know how to express it, and it touched a lot of them." Dolly has spoken over and over again about not just common themes such as femininity, but also things like women in the workforce, the hypersexualization of women, and women in poverty. Dolly drew upon her own life, and because of it, women all over the world have identified with her music. When asked about the song, "I Will Always Love You," she explains that she wrote it in a time where she was in a love-hate relationship. And once it had been released by Whitney Houston, she hadn't even really thought about the song in a long time. She had just sold it off to some producers in LA, and she didn't even know that Whitney had recorded it. She heard it on the radio and she said she had to pull her car over because she almost wrecked because of the pure power and passion in her voice. She felt like Whitney had completely made it her own. Completely different from her own version of it, but also it still held that same sentiment. But clearly, Whitney had applied it to her own life. And that's what Dolly thinks is the beauty of it all, just like so many of the other artists that we've talked about today. Here is my self-accompanied cover of I Will Always Love You by Dolly Parton.
If I should stay, I would only be in your way. So I'll go, but I of the way, and I will always love you. I will always love you. Bittersweet memories. That's all I am taking with me. Goodbye, please don't cry. We both know that I'm not what you need, and I will always love.
And I hope life treats you kind. And I hope you have all you ever dreamed of. And I wish you joy and happiness.
But above all of this, I wish you
is a country singer-songwriter who has won numerous awards for her lyricism. She cites Dolly Parton and Joni Mitchell as huge influences on her music, saying Joni is an observational, autobiographical genius, and Dolly Parton, her now friend, has created wells in which Brandy goes back to time and time again. These wells are of emotions, of ideas, of topics that Brandy has written all of her music about. When asked about what her lyrics actually mean, she talks about her favorite lyricist, Bernie Taupin, who does not explain what his songs are about because he wants to leave them up for interpretation. She says that she made so many songs anthems for parts of her life, and that those moments wouldn't be the same without those anthems. And if she were to tell people exactly what she wrote the song about, she might be depriving them of that as well. She explains, everyone wants to talk about themselves, and songwriting is self-indulgent, and not explaining what the song is about is your big, heroic, generous moment of taking yourself out of the definition and maybe lending it to other people. I think this quote by Brandy really ties together a lot of this idea of connection that all of these artists have talked about, that by writing this music, they are opening the floor for every individual, especially every other woman out there, to identify with it and apply it to their own life, their own struggle. And I think that that's important here to understand. For my final song of this recital, I would like to present you Brandi Carlile's Party of One, accompanied by Dr. David Sievers and sung with Angelo Knight.
Waiter, send this to the table, the party of one. The only other lonely soul in this place. And so you're finishing up your coffee, but then where you gonna run? Where'd you get that look on your face?
You should always let the sun go down on your anger and let it burn you to sleep, and bring it closer to the danger to surrender and retreat. Sing your sad song to sleep.
I loved you the first time I saw you, and you know I love you still. But I am tired, and I am yours. Don't even think about your freedom or taking that flight.
Or going back upon your promises after fighting for the right.
Because your eggshells and your statements and your weaponized words are paper tigers now.
Oh, you're constantly overthinking, and your secretive drinking
are making you more and more alone.
And girl, you can slam the door behind you, it ain't never gonna close. Because when you're home, you're already home. And I am tired, I am tired.
I love you the first time I saw you, and you know I love you still. I don't wanna be right anymore. Lord, I don't wanna fight anymore. Coming home, 'cause I am yours.
I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours.
In conclusion, each of these artists have proven that their writings push far beyond the realm of confessionalism. Although their lyrics may have been inspired by their own lives and personal experience, they write in hopes that others will identify with it themselves. Applying the term confessional to female singer-songwriters not only diminishes the brilliance of their lyricism, but also invalidates their statements on the female experience. Music critics and we as a society need to recognize that the intimacy of these songs don't come from a place of shame or guilt, but rather a place of empathy, acceptance, and bravery. These women have laid their lives out in these tracks, and that should be celebrated rather than be put in a box. Thank you all for coming, and I really appreciate it. If you would like more information, you can check the bio of this YouTube link, and I'll have a link to the program notes and other resources. Thank you again.